Good morning, church. How are we doing this morning? Good, good to see you. Won't you stand with us? Ephesians 2 says this, God saved you by his grace when you believed. And you can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things that we have done, so none of us can boast about it. It says this, for we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. You are a masterpiece of God's work. Isn't that amazing to think about? We've been saved by his grace. Let's think about that this morning. Here we go.
The power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty, yes, so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless and all in wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. That you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan the son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice. Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. The grave, worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave, worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Come on,
worthy is the King who conquered the grave, worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy, worthy. Amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. For me.
gonna be afraid, 'cause these waves are only waves. I'm not gonna be afraid. Thank you. God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do.
Come to you right now. We want to see things the way that you see things. This morning, I pray that you do go before us, that we can grow in our relationship with you and maybe even see you for the first time, to see that you are good and your mercies are new every morning and every day. We thank you for salvation. We thank you for help. You tell us in Scripture, where does our help come from? It comes from you. We thank you for that. Be with us today, God. It's in your name I pray. Amen. You guys can have a seat. Check out these announcements.
Hey guys, good morning and welcome to Parkside. My name is Rachel Menzel and I'm so glad you're joining us today. If you don't know me, I'm the student minister here. And as you can tell, we're filming on Tuesday and it's a little snowy outside, so I hope you guys had a safe and fun week in the snow, but we're so glad that you decided to join us this morning. I just wanted to remind you to be signing up if you are dropping a child off for children's ministry. We just want to make sure that we have enough space and we're safe about it. So there'll be a link on the screen and information of how to sign your child up, but we just want to make sure you're doing that so you can be safe. Shortly before Christmas, a Parkside partner heard from a neighbor they had an unexpected house guest. The house guest recently left her husband when he became physically and emotionally abusive with her, their 2-year-old daughter, and 6-year-old son. Initially, she went to live in a domestic abuse shelter, but she was able to move in with a friend's mother temporarily. The neighbor was able to support her emotionally, but not very well financially. The single mom had 2 children, no home, no job, and no money. She had no way to pay rent, or afford basic needs such as diapers for her daughter and gas money to search for jobs. Not to mention they didn't have food or clothing. The Dollar Club gave the single mom and her children a huge helping hand financially, as well as a huge dose of hope. What a Christmas gift. The Parkside partner who nominated this family was the one who presented the check. She commented to Matt and Greg that she is so blessed to know her church trusts her to give away so much money to a total stranger. Parkside, I want to thank you for making this gift possible. We just an extra dollar a week in your offering is able to make gifts like this possible, and we just want to thank you so much for being able to do that. Parkside, I hope you have a great week. I hope we don't get much more snow, but enjoy this worship service with us.
Good morning. Man, what a cool Dollar Club story. Appreciate your generosity so much in doing that. Although, Rachel, I think my boys are not going to be too happy with you saying, hopefully no more snow. I think they're praying in opposition to that. So they enjoyed all the sledding they were able to do this week. We're going to start off this morning with a prayer time. And we've been talking about how prayer is something we want to emphasize this year, something we want to focus on. And so this morning, we're going to be praying for the churches in our community. Too many churches look at other churches as competition, and that's not the way that it should be. And one of the big reasons that we shouldn't look at other churches as competition is within a 3-mile radius of this church building, there's over 50,000 people. And I mean, can you even imagine right now what it would look like to have socially distanced services for 50,000 people? Right? We'd be going week round. But there are 50,000 people that we want to impact with the love of Jesus, that we want to let them know the good news that has changed our lives. And that's not going to happen just with Parkside. That's going to happen as a teamwork, as a beautiful family of churches. There are so many churches in our community that we should be praying for, and that honestly, we are blessed to share a community with, to be on the same team in the same community. Anderson Hills United Methodist Church, Mark and his team over there, and even Sue Lee at the Salem campus just right down the road, we're so thankful for them. And if you come up the road a little bit, Zion Lutheran and Jason and Chris and their team, they've helped us with the house builds in previous years, just like Anderson Hills has, and it's been incredible getting to do that with them. Brent and Colton at Forestville Baptist Church and what they do with Upwards and the way they impact the community with their Upwards program. That's just incredible. David, Brian, Barry, and Spencer over at Calvary Alliance. We love that church. Even new churches like Seven Hills Church over at Anderson High School, Jake and Corey, they're launching this new campus this next week. And we as a staff have been praying for them for months. We're so excited that their new campus starts next week. How exciting to have more people in our community trying to reach our community with the love of Jesus. Mark Jones and Living Church, and there are more and more that I could go on and keep mentioning, but that's just in our immediate community. And we have an incredibly special privilege today. I mean, what an awesome blessing it is today. We are welcoming People's Church Mount Washington. Everybody give it up for People's Church this morning. Come on up. We asked them to come and pray for them. And you guys are like representing all the churches of our community, but we want to pray for you specifically too. I was just telling Ellie, I was checking in with her. I first met People's Church through Ellie in junior high at the after school club that we had when I was a student minister at Nagel. And through Ellie being a part of that club, I got to meet her dad, who's the campus pastor, Tom, his wife Jamie. I got to meet him, and we started cooperating and working together. We knew each other at that point. But it has been so awesome, not just knowing that you guys are here, not just praying for you all, but actually serving with you. You know, Renee, who does a lot of stuff with Care Portal and does stuff with Mount Washington Elementary, the food drives that you guys have helped provide the materials for, they're providing materials for those two things too, and they're helping distribute them. How neat is it that we're supporting a community, not on our own, but with the capital C Church? So it is, I mean, honestly, worshiping with you all, first service and this service too, it was like, man, this is a little taste of heaven. This is what it's going to be like to be all the churches together worshiping. So I want us to pray for you all. And then if you guys could, anything that you want to share or pray for us, that'd be great too. But Parkside, we don't want to pass on any germs we might have. So just go ahead and extend a hand towards them. They don't want to smell our morning breath either, right? Let's pray for People's Church and pray for all of our churches too. God, we love you so much. And we're so thankful for People's Church Mount Washington. Lord, we care so much about Mount Washington and Anderson and our community. And they care for it too, Lord. Just like we want to have the heart of Jesus, Lord, you have placed your heart within People's Church. And so, Lord, we pray that you'd bless them, that you would strengthen them, that you would give them a peace. And Lord, give them a presence in their community. Lord, I pray that they would be like Joshua, that everywhere they set their feet, you would give to the kingdom. Lord, that no weapon formed against them would prosper. But Lord, that you would bless the work of their hands. Let your spirit be at work powerfully in People's Church. And as they are involved in their community, as they lead their businesses within the Mount Washington community, and as they are involved in the neighborhoods, bless that, Lord. Help people who run into People's Church, who bump into their members, their family, to just say, there is something about you that I need to know more of. Lord, I just pray that you would bless the kingdom work that they're doing, that Tom and Jamie and so many of these people are doing, and the church that they represent. And Lord, we want to pray for the capital C Church. We want to pray for the other churches in our community and the work they're doing. We want to pray for Jake and Corey as they're launching Seven Hills next week here in Anderson Township. Lord, bless that church like crazy, because we don't want to see little forts, little kingdoms all over this community. We want to see the capital C Church recognized. We want to see the 50,000 people reached and mobilized and sent out to reach the world. We pray that you would bless this church and help all of our churches to fulfill the mission you've sent us on, Lord. Thank you so much. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, good morning, Parkside. It's so encouraging to be with you today. This is a cup-filling experience for us. We planted about 3 years ago, and almost exactly a year ago, we were told that Sands Montessori, where we meet, was closing its doors because of COVID. And so we, what did you say?
Oh, closing to us, not.
Yeah, yeah. No. Well, and students went online, and so we've been a church that's been homeless. We've been online. We've enjoyed fellowship with other churches. We've met in the park even. And today, just to be encouraged by you, to know that you're praying for us, to be one in this community is just awesome. Thankful for Pastor Matt. He is so kind, so open-handed, fun to be around. I think he's even cool. Don't you guys think he's pretty cool?
Not quite there.
And we're just excited for what God's going to do. Not just in this moment, but really this is the beginning of a continuing of a partnership between our churches.
Amen.
So thank you for today.
Yeah, we are so grateful to be with you all today, to be among friends, to be among partners in the gospel. And we just want to thank you for the good work you're doing in this zip code and beyond. And as Christians, we're called to love deeply, right? To love across divides. And there are some big divides that we face in our nation, in our world, and I would say even in zip code 45230, right?
Yeah.
So as a church, our vision is really to not only love across those divides, but to occupy some space of healing among those divides, of racial divide, of divide amongst socioeconomic difference, and even generational differences. So we feel called to be that church that Jesus called us all to be in Revelation chapter 5, the church that he said he bought with his blood.
Amen.
A diversely united church that would look like heaven will look, with representatives from every tongue, tribe, and nation. So we're excited to just be, again, partners with you in the good work you're doing. We really feel called to Mount Washington proper and beyond, and that's we're really praying for a permanent space in Mount Washington proper. So if God puts you on our heart, you know, just believe with us for that, and we look forward to doing ministry with you all through the years to come.
Amen.
So now we want to pray for you, Parkside. Lord, thank you so much for this amazing church body. I thank you for their faith, their radical generosity. Lord, this is an outward-focused church. They've invested in this community and beyond. I thank you for their partnerships all around the world with missionaries and their radical generosity in prayers, their giving, their going, their investment in people groups who desperately need life-giving churches. Lord, today we pray a blessing on Pastor Matt and Elisha. We thank you for this mantle of leadership, this season where you've called them to lead Parkside, to steward this beautiful family. God, we pray for favor for their household and their four boys. And Lord, we also today pray for each household represented here today. We pray, Father, where there's lack, that there would be plenty. We pray where there's discouragement, there'd be joy. Pray where there's heartache, there'd be healing. And Lord, that you would just, in the season ahead, restore everything that the locusts have eaten, everything that seems taken away. God, we pray that you'd bring it back many times more. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. And People's Church, they said that if I did a good job first service, they would stay for my message second service. Well, guys, you are in for a good one today then. So, no, everybody, thanks so much for being here. They were great. And they did. They sat through all of first service, and I think they even managed to stay awake, so what a blessing. What a cool morning to be able to do that. And let's keep praying for the churches in our community as we serve in mission together. We're really glad that you're worshiping with us this morning, whether you're here in person or you're worshiping from home. We are still working our way through the Puzzled series. And if you have not caught all of it, I would encourage you to go online to YouTube and get caught up on whatever you've missed for whatever reason. But earlier in this series, I shared with you a picture of the puzzle that the Robinson family was working on. And you might be thinking that I'm coming back to it to tell you, hey, we finished it. We haven't. We're not close. We've gotten past all the easy stuff, right? We finished the edge pieces, we finished the train, the bridge, and now we're stuck with all the complicated stuff. The blue water, the blue skies, all the greens of the hills and the trees. And honestly, there have been plenty of times this week where I've walked past that puzzle, thought about doing some of it, and went, nope, not today. And I think we all know there is a big difference between doing five pieces of a puzzle a day and a week where you just look at it and go, nope. In our spiritual lives, it's the same thing that's true, right? The struggle, the battle is real. There's areas of our faith, areas of obedience to God that aren't easy, that are difficult, challenging, or messy, that we look at and we just go, you know, not today. You know, I'm just not going to deal with that today. And honestly, procrastination is not the only battle we face in our spiritual life. There is a very real battle going on around us and a very real enemy. And to overcome the enemy that we're facing, we need to know who that enemy is, and we need to know the right weapons to defeat them. And today, we're going to take a hard look at the battlegrounds, our enemy, and the weapons we're supposed to employ. This week, all throughout the week, I've been talking with one of our mission partners that we support that serves in Africa. And I've talked with you about this this partner before. Due to the region they're in and the risks involved, I can't be more specific about where they're at or what they're doing. But all throughout this week, I've been talking with them and praying for them, because several more locals, I talked to you at the end of last year, in the fall of last year, about locals being arrested for being believers. There have been several more arrests in the past several weeks, and no one knows if there's going to be more people arrested, if people are going to be asked to leave the country, or what punishments are in store for those that are arrested right now, simply because they've converted. They've said, "My faith is in Jesus." It's a scary time. Our friends are having to exercise a great amount of caution right now because of the scrutiny they're under by local officials. But these believers who have been imprisoned, and other local believers, they're not shying away or retreating in this moment. The people that have been held captive, the people that have been arrested, are actively explaining and sharing their beliefs with their captors. It would be so easy, so natural, so understandable for them to see the people that have arrested them as their enemies. But they know that spiritually, they're not just not enemies. They are their mission. Even while they're being detained by these people, they are actively pursuing them with the love of Jesus. They recognize who their real enemy is and isn't. And we can't be effective in our mission if we don't recognize who our real enemy is. The enemy that we are at war against is not another human being. We're not at war with people that have a different political affiliation than us. We are not at war with atheists, Islamists, Buddhists, or any other worldview. We are actually fighting for them. Our war is not a culture war. It's not a religious freedom war. Either. We have been given the mission to oppose not people, but oppose the devil with the Word of God. And the mission that we've been given is to take the Word of God, to take the good news of the gospel of God to our community. But the reason we have to be so careful in recognizing who our enemy is because it's all too natural to start having collateral damage, to start having friendly fire, to battle against each other, or to battle against the very people we've been sent to. The enemy is very real and very dangerous. Listen to what Jesus and his disciples have to say about our enemy in John chapter 10, verse 10. "The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy." This is Jesus talking. "The thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full." Peter, talking about the same thing in 1 Peter 5. "Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of sufferings." 2 Corinthians 10, this is Paul speaking now. "For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ." When I worked at Canyon Ridge Christian Church in Las Vegas, one of the pastors on staff told me a story. Ian Kirk told me this story of when he grew up in Las Vegas. He was there at a time where the city was still predominantly run by the mob, by organized crime. And he said that as a teenager, or as a young adult, he worked at the Cadillac dealership in Las Vegas. And so he was working at this dealership. He was still relatively new. And one day in the showroom, a man came behind the desk and opened up the cabinet that had all the keys to the new Cadillacs. And he started to stand up and physically confront this man. And one of his coworkers put a hand on his shoulder and said, "Just wait." And so the man went through the keys, picked out a new Cadillac, walked out of the showroom onto the lot, and drove that new Cadillac off the lot. And his coworker said, those guys pretty much get whatever they want. And it dawned on Ian what was going on. That this wasn't your regular customer. This wasn't just somebody off the street. This was part of that organized crime group, that mob that were pulling the strings, running the show, almost invisible the whole time. It was an evil that was present, but you'd miss it completely if you weren't paying attention. It might have looked like an oasis in the desert. Las Vegas might have been established as this place that you can go to, but underneath it was a system built to lure you in and bleed you dry. C.S. Lewis said, there are two equal and opposite errors into which our race can fall about the devils. One is to disbelieve in their existence. The other is to believe and to feel an excessive and unhealthy interest in them. It's important that we aren't blind to the enemy that we're facing, the enemy that is out to get us. We need to know him. We need to know his tactics and know his strategy as well. But it's not enough to know who he is or what his strategy is. We need to know what the strategy is that God has given us to oppose him. We have to practice it on a regular basis so that when life gets crazy, we respond naturally with our training. Mike Tyson said, everybody's got a plan until they get punched in the face. And he would know. That dude has punched a lot of people in the face. And he's gotten punched in the face before, right? The really crazy thing about that statement is he said that right before he bit a dude's ear off, right? He said that before he faced Evander Holyfield. Then he gets in the ring with him and he doesn't punch him in the face. He bites his ear. The enemy that we are facing isn't going to fight fair, isn't going to play nice or play by the rules. The enemy is going to do whatever it can to make us live ineffective, unfulfilled lives where we never discover our purpose. We could spend the whole morning talking about different strongholds, areas where we give the enemy territory, where we let sin creep into our life and we give the devil a foothold. We have to be so careful that we're on our guard about those things, that we guard the way we live our lives, the things we surround ourselves with, that we stay connected and in communication with God and with other believers so that both those voices can hold us accountable so that we don't give the devil a foothold. But I want to share another strategy that I think the devil uses against God's church and on all of humanity. I was talking to a friend of mine this week down in Louisville who I have an immense amount of respect for because of the way he lives out his faith and the work that he's done globally to reach unreached people with the gospel. He is a disciple who makes disciples. And so I asked him, I said, what do you think is the biggest thing that prevents us as Christians from being effective in the Great Commission, from reaching all people with the good news of Jesus? And his answer has really echoed in my mind as I've gotten ready for this message. He said, I immediately go to the parable of the seeds. You can look it up in Matthew 13, Mark 4, Luke 8. But it's this parable of the farmer casting seeds out in his field. And it's all about the type of soil that you are, the places where soil grows good seeds and the places where the soil isn't healthy enough for the seeds to grow. He said, I think that story is about us and what type of soil we are, but I think we can see the strategies of the devil in the way that that story is told. He talks about a few different types of seeds in that parable, Jesus does. He talks about the seeds that fall on the path. Seeds that never come to an understanding of who Jesus is. My friend said, you know, I think so many of us never are open to Jesus. There's so many people in our communities that say, that's great that you found Jesus, and that's good for you, but that's not for me. I could never be good enough for Jesus, or it's really just a you thing. People who keep Jesus at just an arm's length. And that's one of the reasons that it's so important for us to be living out our faith, sharing our faith, so that people can see that Jesus is more than they expect. And that he is for all people. Satan wants us to keep from ever embracing Jesus so that we don't experience his goodness. Another type of soil are the soil that is filled with rocks, and the seeds fall among the rocks. And this is Jesus, when he explains the parable, says it's people who come to know Jesus but then abandon him because life gets tough. If you became a Christian so that life wouldn't be tough, then you might have come to Jesus for the wrong reasons. Because Jesus doesn't save us from our lives being tough. He doesn't save us from hardship. He gives us hope in the midst of hardship. I think it's important to say in this moment too, as we talk about the devil's strategies, we need to be really careful when we call something spiritual warfare. You know, we might have lost a job. We might have lost a loved one. We might be experiencing illness. It might be somebody that we really care about, that we know loves us, but speaks a really careless word in our lives. Could that be spiritual warfare? Yeah, it could be. But we don't know if it is. And just like that C.S. Lewis quote, we need to make sure that our focus isn't in the wrong place. We need to keep our eyes on Jesus, not on the hardships we're experiencing. And then the last area that he mentioned was the seeds that grow among the thorns. And this is the thing that really stood out to me that he said. The seeds among the thorns in this story grow really fast, but they never bear any fruit. And Jesus, when he explains the parable, says, it's because they're choked out by the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth. He said, most Christians I meet are not being fruitful or faithful because of the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of money. The devil is going to try and distract you from your purpose, from fulfilling the mission, the Great Commission, telling the world about Jesus, by distracting you with your day-to-day life and distracting you with stuff. And so look at your heart. Are you being faithful? Because I think if we're being faithful, we're going to be fruitful. Is God growing things in your life? Is God growing things in the lives of those around you? The devil's going to do whatever he can to keep us from doing those things. In Ephesians chapter 6, Paul tells us it's not just who our battle is against, but that we need to wear the right armor and use the right weapons. You can follow along in verses 10 through 17. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle isn't against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. There's a spiritual battle going on that we need to see. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you have done everything to stand, stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. I love that. Be strong in the Lord. Put on the armor so you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. I've heard this passage taught before from the standpoint that all these things, all this armor that we're supposed to put on, all these weapons we're supposed to use, all of them are for defense except for the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And I've heard it taught that God fights our battles for us. Everything that we put on for the battle is to protect us, and the only weapon we're using against the enemy is God's word, God's actions, his very spirit. He fights for us. He protects us. And I've also heard it taught that Paul is comparing this armor to a Roman soldier's armor that he would likely have been envisioning as he wrote this passage. And that Roman soldiers, their shields were not shields that they used for themselves, but they used for the person next to them. And so as they fought, they protected, they used their faith to guard the well-being of those around them. And that's true as well. We need to make sure that we are fighting arm in arm, protecting each other. Both of those statements are very true and very applicable, but I want to talk about something else today that stood out to me as I got ready and looked through this passage this week. Listen for a second, not to the pieces of armor, but the qualities or titles Paul puts behind them. Truth, righteousness, the gospel of peace, faith, salvation, the word of God. That's what we're fighting with. Those aren't the weapons that most people would bring into a battle, but it's what God wants us to use. I've only been to a firing range once or twice, but without fail, if you spend any time at a gun range or a firing range, there will be someone that brings out these crazy weapons that you didn't even know, like, who has a bazooka in their closet? And like, is it legal to fire a Desert Eagle that has like tank rounds as a handgun? I mean, it's just crazy the things that you see. Those are the weapons that you think God would give us to take into battle. You know, you wouldn't think that it would be the truth, righteousness, gospel of peace, faith, and salvation. You think it would be, you know, these weapons that would obliterate your enemy, eviscerate, destroy. What does it look like to put our trust in God's truth? To place our battle in His righteousness, not our own righteousness, but His. To trust each of our steps to the gospel of peace. How do we make war? How do we fight an enemy? With the gospel of peace. To place our faith in God's protection of us. To let our minds be led and guided by salvation, the grace He has given us, and to go on the offensive, not by our own strength, not by our own firepower, but by the words of God and in the power of His Spirit. That's not the battle I have in mind, but that's how God says we're supposed to fight, by standing firm in who He has said we are. And letting Him fight for us. It makes me think about the capital C church, not just Parkside Church, not just churches of Anderson, Mount Washington, or Cincinnati, but the world. People like our brothers and sisters sitting in jail cells right now simply because they're Christians. They are showing us the power of the armor and the weapons God has told us to take into battle. They are using the right weapons, and they are fighting the right battle that they cannot lose. 1 John 4:4, you, dear children, are from God and have overcome them because the one who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. Before teenage David went and fought Goliath, the ultimate warrior, he said, you come at me with a sword and a shield and a javelin, spear, but I come against you in the name of the Lord God Almighty. If I am standing in the power of God, what could you possibly do to me? We have to remember, though, that we're not fighting against each other. We're not fighting against our community. We're resisting the attacks of the devil, and we're standing in God's power to fight for the lives of our community. We're going to enter into a time of communion, and I'd like to frame communion a little bit differently as we go into it this morning. I want us to consider what Jesus did for us on the cross. Jesus said that when we have communion, we should take it in remembrance of Him. There was a time in Matthew chapter 20 where James and John's mom came to Jesus and said, hey, Jesus, when you're in your kingdom, when you're sitting on your throne, can James and John sit on your right and your left? And Jesus said, do you even realize what you're asking for? He said, do you know the suffering that I'm going to go through? Can they drink from that same cup? We want to be a church that's close to Jesus. But we need to realize that if we're going to be close to Jesus, we are going to experience the suffering that Jesus faced. Jesus finishes that story by saying, the Son of Man, Jesus, did not come to be served, but to serve, and to serve as a ransom for many. So as we have communion today, I want you to ask yourself that question. Are you willing to serve our community? Are you willing to sacrifice for our community the way that Jesus served and sacrificed so that you could know Jesus' love? Let me pray. God, we love you so much, and we're so thankful for what you've done for us. Lord, open our eyes up to the plans of the enemy, the attacks of the enemy. But even in that, Lord, help us to not focus so much on that. Help us to focus on you. Lord, you say that we should surround ourselves, that we should arm ourselves with your words, with your spirit, that we should guard ourselves with your salvation, our faith, your truth, your righteousness. Lord, help us to do that. Help us to realize who our real enemy is. And help us to realize who our mission is so that we can take them the love of Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.
To stand as we continue in our worship.
stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working.
Who you are the way maker. And I pray this morning we don't just leave it right here, that we understand that this week we can apply it in our lives, that we can see who the real enemy is. It's not with each other, God. I pray that you give us courage and strength. Just give us faith to see that. Go before us, God. Let us be more like you. It's in your name I pray. Amen. You guys have a great week.